has may use only written information to predict users' preference. And then, but now we also have text information like user reviews. So I think it's like relevant to the workshop topic that we are mining user reviews in order to make decisions about user review predictions and making recommendations. So the general background of the topic is that the recommender system can be very helpful in the current scenario where users are presented with millions of choices of products on e-commerce websites. Although it's good that we have so many choices, but it's also like introducing a huge burden or cognitive information overload for users to choose or compare different products. So our recommender system can help by reducing the scope of all choices and also help users to make better decisions. So how does recommender system work? Traditionally, people use collector filtering, which is basically when we have collected some enough data about users' ratings on different products, we will do matrix factorization to get the hidden vectors for users and for products. Then these hidden vectors for users and products can be used for recommendation either with like peer nearest neighbors or some supervised approach. So the, although a collective filtering works pretty well, but there are some issues and challenges too. So the first thing is that the metrics for user and product rating has to be not very sparse. So when the metrics is very sparse, meaning there hasn't been any much ratings collected in the system, then the metrics factorization may be less effective. But nowadays, in addition to those discrete signals like likes, ratings, or even clicks, we also have some unstructured data, which are like user comments, user reviews, that may be very potentially very helpful for us to improve the rating prediction. Because when user write a review, it may say sentiments about the product, also discuss different aspects about the product in the text information. And if we can extract or utilize such information in a wise way, then it's possible that the rating prediction can be improved. So we are the current study is along this line of work. So the agenda is that we will first quickly go over the related work, and then we will discuss the methodology we use, and then we will discuss experimental results, case studies, and job conclusion. So first of all, related work. So how do we incorporate text information into recommender system? Before the deep learning era, when people are using collector filtering, which you actually get the hidden dimensions of users and products, it's the most straightforward or intuitive way is also to change the text reviews into some hidden dimensions, which help modeling perfectly serve its purpose. So there are some work along this line like HFT, GMARS, and RMR. So what they did is to do topic modeling on the text reviews to represent them as topic distributions, and then align these hidden distributions with the hidden dimensions in the matrix factorization so that the eventual matrix factorization incorporates both information from reading and information from topics. The advantage is that there are concrete evidence that this actually improves the performance of reading prediction. However, there are some issues that with topic modeling when the text review are very short, which then the topic modeling may fail, which is a general behavior of topic modeling. The other thing is that the back of words representation in topic modeling may not capture like the sentence structure or the term dependency in the log of it. So the second line of work actually try to use like more recent deep learning approach to model the text reviews and represent it with some kind of neural models. So before that, we also need to consider, okay, so for collector filtering, it's matrix factorization. How do we incorporate neural models into the factorization? So for that, people have introduced the deep collector filtering network, which looks like this. So basically, you have a representation of a user and an item as a vector. This vector can be anything. It can be a representation of the test document, or it's some randomized, initialized vector that can be tuned with this network. And then you combine the representation of both and feed them into the global layer. The author of this paper has proved that this is equivalent to a vectorization machine that may have higher level nonlinearity depending on how complex these feed-forward layers are. So given this structure, then many different text representations under the deep learning framework can be plotted here on top of the representation for users and items. So there are a line of work that use different variants of CNN networks to plot here as a representation of user and item. And there are also papers that use RNN models to plot in this place. So the current paper, the current study will focus on the CNN variants. So in addition to how you represent the user and item with different neural network models, it also matters how you combine them here. Some people have tried using concatenation of the two representation, or using dot product, or using even factorization machine. So how you combine them also matters. So the problem with current CNN based approach is that because it's type information different from computer vision, we actually do one dimensional convolution on the text embeddings. So we just do average pooling or max pooling on the one-dimensional feature map, which actually we don't actually take into consideration between the interactions between the hidden dimensions in the feature vector space. So the current study is trying to see if we can improve on that part. So the third line of related work that is related to the current topic is quantum light language model. This line of work basically borrow some concepts from the quantum physics theory, but use it for language modeling. So a quick example is that imagine that we have a vocabulary that only has three words, which is computer, architecture, and some other things. Then the word will represent it as 011 and 101. Then let's say that we have some document actually has the weights for both words like this. Then in a one-dimensional representation, the document will be represented as this. So it's similar to how you represent document in information retrieval. But in quantum language model, we're actually going to get the outer product of this vector, which is going to be this vector, this matrix. So that each document or text or any text representation, instead represented as a 1D vector, now they're represented 2D. So it means that the 2D representation will take into consideration not only on the diagonal width, but also the covariance on the non-diagonal elements. So that's the basic idea of the quantum language model. And then the problem is how to derive such weights in the quantum language model. One earlier work, they actually used an expectation maximization algorithm, and later work just trained the weights from the neural network end-to-end in the end-to-end function. So next I will discuss my methodology. So this may seem like a little bit too much, but because these are the formalities for a quantum language model, but actually when we go to the model structure, it's pretty simple and straightforward. So I'll just quickly go over this. So the quantum language model, quantum physics are initially in the Hilbert space, but for the language model here, you actually simplify it to a real space, a real finite space. And a unit vector is just a vector that is L2 norm is 1. And then the column vector of the unit vector is called cat, and the flow vector is called rock. So for any vector here, it can be a one-hop embedding, a one-hop encoding, or a sentence word embedding or an algorithm feature embedding. Then the beta of that is actually you take the outer product of the row of the column vector and the row vector. Basically, you just take out product of the vector itself, then you will get a 2D representation. And this 2D representation is called the elementary events in the quantum space. So then for each of the quantum space, it also has a probability, like in our usual events probability space. So the probabilistic density function will map any of these elementary events into a value between 0 and 1. And let's say that we have a set of orthogonal basis unit vectors, then the density function will map the probabilities and sum them up to 1. So how do we derive such density function? It turns out that there is a density matrix called rho, and that if we multiply rho by the ket, then by the bra, and for that matrix we take the diagonal to get the trace, that value will be exactly the probability of this elementary function. So the final goal of all this representation is that we're going to need to derive the density matrix, which is that if we know the density matrix, we can guess the probability of any elementary events. And the density matrix itself has the property that it can be factorized with a set of eigenvectors and eigenvalues. And the property is that then it satisfies that the matrix is positive, semi-definite, and sum-to-1 for the diagonal. So this is the overall structure of the model. So so first you got embeddings of the user and the item from their review document. And then you do one convolutional operation. And from there we did the quantum language modeling layer, which is to map this convolutional feature map into a 2D DAS. So each of the feature vector in the CN layer will be mapped to a 2D DAS. And then we get the weighted density matrix by multiplying all these DAS with their corresponding probabilities. And these probabilities here in this end-to-end network will be learned by the network of network. So eventually we get representation for each user and an itemizer 2D matrix. And then we get their mutual attention matrix and do some kind of rope pooling and color pooling to get their final representation and use them to predict the ratings. So more specifically, so the embedding layer is just similar to any other embedding layer. We use pre-trained word embedding, or we can initialize it randomly. And for the convolutional layer, it's typical one-dimensional convolution on top of the text word embedding. And then the bias is that for each of the feature vector, we're going to first normalize it to a unit, to a normal L2, norm 1. And then we're going to just do outer product of this feature vector to get a 2D matrix. And then for all the 2D matrix, we're going to get a weighted 2D matrix by multiplying the probability for each of the position in the feature map. And eventually, because the density matrix has the probability that it has to be positive, semi-definite, which already satisfies because it's a weighted sum of the outer products. But third one is that it has to be summed up to 1 on the diagonal, we just add a loss to enforce that part. So after we get the density matrix, we do a multiplication of the two density matrices. So this part is how to combine the two representations, which also matters. So because there are two 2D matrices, so we cannot just do some concatenation because it will be immensely large. So what we do is we get the multiplication matrix, which we call mutual attention matrix, and then we do row pooling and column pooling to get a vector. This vector actually signals, okay, so for the user and the item, there may be some hidden dimensions that are shared or overlapped by the two. So for example, when user says something about battery in his review document, it means the user cares more about battery. But for this product, it's also mentioned by many users that battery is good or bad. Then this battery aspect or hidden feature should be highlighted more in the final representation for user and item instead of taking everything equally. So So the role-playing and column-playing is working towards that goal. And eventually, use this query as attention, we use that to get the weighted vector of the density matrix of user and item, and got a final 1D representation of each. And we also take the diagonal elements vector as a final representation, as well as the trace. So the final representation will be both the trace and the diagonal elements, as well as the 1D final representation of user and the product. And then use that, we feed this long vector through several physical legs and get the final by reading. And the final loss is decided by the MSE loss. So eventually the final loss will be the reading loss between the reading loss as well as the constraint loss that we want the density matrix from their diagonal elements they need to sum up to one. So this is all the the model structure. Any questions? Okay. Please feel free to ask questions in the end or during the presentation. So for the experiment part, we actually use two data sets. One is Amazon called 5-part review data sets. We didn't use all the data sets, but only using the 5-part because we are not targeting cold start problems specifically. So we want to make sure that every user and every product in this data set has at least 5 reviews. And we also use the Yelp reading prediction data set. And so for the representation of each user and product, we actually take all the reviews this user made into one document, but except the exact reviews that will be used for testing. So for example, I have commented on a product A, then I cannot use, I want to predict this this reading, I cannot use this review in my training data because then there will be leakage that the model already knows user preference for this product. Then for each of the test document, we have delimiters between each review and also between each sentence, and all the whole document is then truncated or padded to the same length to fit into the CN layer. So we also use pre-trained word embedding, that it is pre-trained on Google News, for our initial word embedding. The evaluation metric we use are MAE, which we choose it over RMSE because it seems to be less sensitive to outliers. And for baselines, the first one we chose is PEMF, which is a classical metrics characterization approach that is only used reading information. And the second one, HFT, is the one that uses topic modeling combined with metric factorization, which is a very good model for the deep learning factor. And the next four are the variants of deep neural models that use CN representations for reading prediction. And the last one is our model. So for training videos, we randomly split the data into training data and test, and tune all the parameters based on the dev data set. And these are the results on the Amazon data set and the Yelp data set. So the first one is only using reading information, and the second one is the topic modeling combined with factorization, and the last one is our method. So from this we can see that for HFT, which actually use topic modeling, is almost consistently performs better than using reading alone, except one here, which is a very small data set. And this is also the same case for Transnet here. It's a CN variance. So we can have some conclusions or tentative findings that incorporating test information is definitely helpful to improve reading prediction. However, for the other three, CNN-based model like deep cold CNN, NARI, and dual intent, their performance kind of vary. For dual intent, in some cases, it's worse than even PMF, but when the data set goes larger, it's actually performed much better. And the other two, in my experiment, is consistently worse than the HFT and the PMF. So my finding, or my understanding, is that how the test information is incorporated into the fiber condition actually matters. It's not that as long as we have test information, it's always going to improve. And our models can perform relatively better on this data set. So we also do some evaluation tests. So we have the part that has the quantum language layer for the representation of text. We also have the mutual attention layer that tries to communicate between use and the product representation. So how do they do independently? You can see that use each of the components independently as this line and this line. The performance can already improve quite a bit. By combining them together, it can have an even small margin of improvement. So for case studies, the first case study is to actually visualize randomly a user's density matrix and the density matrix of a product. So it is trying to see what if the density matrix is identity matrix, then in that case, it actually doesn't matter if it's 1D or 2D. But we can see it's very unlikely that the density matrix is identity matrix. And there will always be some values that are strong signals on the non-diagonal area, which means that density matrix can capture more information compared to 1D representation. And then we also visualize the strong words by highlight the probabilities across different positions when we use them to weight the dice and get the final density matrix. So from the highlights, we can see that first of all, the highlights are many of the words are actually sentimental, like I love the story, their quality shows in every episode. So it means that the model seems to be focusing on some sentimental words to make the final prediction, which is something we want the model to have. And the other thing is that although we take the assumption that we initialize the p-value for different positions with different value, but conversely, the p-value will be high if it's the same word that happens at different position. So we can see we have my own worst and my own worst. Is that for different position of the same program, the p-value will be consistently higher. So our final conclusion is that we propose a density matrix. So the text representation we use, which is the quantum lifetime density matrix layer, helps to improve the reading performance. And also, we also use the mutual attention matrix to communicate between user and product reading, which also helps to improve the reading prediction. And third is that the test information, if we can incorporate them wisely, it should be able to improve the reading. We also try to apply this in our future experiments on other variants of neural net models other than CNNs. So that's all of my presentation. Any questions?
Let's first thank the speaker.
So the current study, we haven't done that, but that's definitely something that is very interesting to explore. Like for data sets, like we have at least level zero review or one or two review or more, we can just slide that threshold to see the performance change. And also we can compare this with other text-based models, like those other CNN models, to see, okay, so now when we have very few readings and reviews, how does each model perform for the reading prediction? Because these models are supposed to be perform better when there's less reading, but there's still text in